Well, we say quite often that we believe that the gospel transforms hearts and that transformed people make an impact in the world. And we also believe that the church, we as a church, are to be a blessing to our community, to our neighbors. And one of the ways we do that is through a ministry called Royal Family Kids Camp. You just watched the short video there. And if you want to find out more and how you can be a play a part in that particular way of blessing our community, stop by the kiosk out in the lobby. You'll see all the purple out there, the balloons and so forth. They can answer questions, give you some information, and help you decide whether that's something that God is calling you to do or not. Well, I want to begin today with an old Chinese proverb I came across years ago. It goes like this. There was once a poor farmer and his son, and they had very little, except they did have a beautiful horse. The horse helped them with the work of the farm. And one day, the horse up and ran away, and all the villagers, the friends of the farmer, came and said, "Oh, we're so sorry. What a terrible thing. Your horse has run away. Now you can't do the work of the farm." And the farmer said, "Well, maybe it's a bad thing. Maybe it's a good thing. We don't really know yet." And then a few weeks later, the horse came back, bringing a whole herd of wild horses with him. All the villagers said, "What a great thing. You're now a rich man. You have lots of horses. Your horse came back and brought all these horses." The farmer said, "Well, maybe it's good. Maybe it's bad. We don't really know enough yet." A few weeks went by, and the farmer's son went to ride one of the wild horses, and the horse threw him off, broke his leg. And all the villagers said, "Oh, what a terrible thing. Your son has broken his leg. He can't help you with the work at the farm now. How bad?" And he said, "Well, maybe it's bad. Maybe it's good. We're not really sure yet." Sometime after that, the whole nation went to war, and all the young men of the community that were healthy went and fought the battles in the war. And the people said, "Oh, look, you're blessed. What a good thing. Your son stays home. He hasn't had to go out and fight in the war." And the farmer, of course, said, "Well, maybe so, maybe not. We don't know yet." Now, the moral of that little parable is, of course, that as human beings, our vision is limited. We simply can't see the future or how all the different events of our lives tumble together and may or may not be part of a larger story. From a spiritual point of view, if we believe in a sovereign and personal God, we can't always see or understand how His great story intersects with our little individual stories. We can't always see. And that's where we begin today. We're in a year-long theme called the story of God as we go through the first two books of the Bible, Genesis and Exodus. And now we're in a mini-series called Family. And we've seen that the book of Genesis tracks the family that began with God's promise to a man named Abraham. That before Abraham even had children, God said, "I'll make you into a great nation, and through you I'll bless all the peoples of the earth." And we saw how that promise tracked down through Abraham's son Isaac, and then to Isaac's twin sons Jacob and Esau. And last week, Jeff talked to you about this strange story of Jacob wrestling with the fierce and loving God who was willing to wrestle with him into surrender, into genuine blessing. And today we look at Jacob's family. We move on to Genesis chapter 37. I'm going to cover lots of text today, so we'll try to follow along by watching the screens or even in your own Bible. Genesis 37, beginning in verse 2. "These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was pasturing the flock with his brothers. He was a boy with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives." Now, the issue of polygamy in the Old Testament is a story for another time, but you'll notice quite often the men had multiple wives. "And Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father." Let me interrupt here again. Joseph is the 11th of 12 sons born to Jacob and his several wives. Here we see he's running back home from the workplace to sort of tattle on his big brothers to their father. How many of you think that's going to go well for Joseph? Okay. Now Israel, of course, was the new name, new identity God gave to Jacob after their epic wrestling match. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he was the son of his old age. Now where do you think Israel or Jacob learned to favor one child over another? From his own parents, right? His mother favored him, his father favored his brother Esau, and we saw the rift that created between the brothers. "And he made him a robe of many colors." This was evidently a long, ornate robe that would have been one like one worn by a prince or someone very wealthy or favored. And it set Joseph apart from his brothers. Verse 4, But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peacefully to him. As we begin, I want you to remember that last week Jeff talked about how the Bible is not intended to just give us pictures of heroically spiritual people that we're supposed to emulate in our lives. That's not the point of the Bible. The point of the Bible is the story of the God who redeems broken and sinful people. So that's what we see here. We see even in this family, the family of Joseph and Jacob, there is pain and dysfunction. As the 11th of 12 sons, Joseph is Jacob's favorite, and so he gives them a coat of many colors. You remember that from Sunday school class. But this coat does two things. First, it tells the other brothers that Joseph is daddy's favorite, and it also indicates that one day he, like a prince, is going to rule over the family, to be the family leader, which of course he will be, but they don't know that yet. Story moves on through chapter 37. Their hatred of their brother grows when he starts sharing with them his dreams. We'll talk more about dreams in a few weeks. But Joseph has these dreams. He tells his older brothers about them, and all the dreams eventually end up with the older brothers bowing down to the younger brother. And of course, they don't like that. They finally have had enough of their obnoxious and precocious little brother, so they decide to get rid of him. They're going to kill him and tell their father he was eaten by a wild animal. And then Reuben, one of the other brothers, says, well, let's not kill him. Let's sell him as a slave. That way our hands are not bloody. And so that's what they decide to do. They throw him in a pit, and they wait for an opportunity. And then in verse 28 we read, then Midianite traders passed by, and they drew Joseph up and lifted him out of the pit and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver. They took Joseph to Egypt. So Joseph's story starts what I'm calling a raw deal. Gets a raw deal. Of all the things we could say, watching our nation over the past couple of weeks, and we could disagree and agree on all kinds of things, but one thing just struck me as I watched all the stuff surrounding the election and so forth, and that is a 10-year-old boy who's now in the spotlight, Barron Trump. 10 years old, in about fourth grade, and he is now thrust into the white-hot spotlight of having a father who is 70 years old, President of the United States and a billionaire, having a mother who's a former supermodel, having half siblings that are old enough to be his parents. His oldest half sibling is 38 and he's 10. Plus he's going to eventually live in the White House, and he'll be followed by paparazzi and reporters every day of his life in his pre-adolescent years. Part of me just goes, that kid's got no chance to live a normal life. What would that be like? And in a way, that's the same way with this young man, Joseph. If this wasn't a Bible story, and I know that it is, but if it wasn't a Bible story, we'd be tempted to look at his early life and say, you know, he's just got no chance. The deck is stacked against him. Consider, he's spoiled rotten by his own father, who makes no secret of the fact that Joseph is his favorite, gives him a fancy schmancy coat just to prove it. Now, this would be like giving your youngest son, or one of your younger sons, a sports car upon graduation when all his older brothers got a tricycle. That's what this feels like to the older brothers. And then he's hated by his own brothers. Now, sibling rivalry is one thing. All families experience some kind of sibling rivalry, but hating your younger brother enough to kill him and convince your father he was eaten by a wild animal, that's a little different thing than sibling rivalry. And then they decide, well, let's not kill him. We'll just sell him as a slave. Okay, that's better, right? We're going to sell him as a slave. And you may not notice, but they sell him to the Midianites, who, as we find out later in the book of Judges, are like the terrorists of the ancient world. So this might be worse than if they just killed him and blame it on a wild animal. So if this was all we knew of Joseph's story, we would probably assume that he was destined inevitably to descend into a spiral of bitterness and rage and self-destructive behavior, that ultimately his life would be sad, violent, and short. That's what it looks like. I mean, what could be worse than being sold as a slave by your own family? But then we see, if you keep reading, the raw deal becomes kind of a good deal. We jump ahead to Genesis chapter 39, verse 1. Now Joseph had been brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard, an Egyptian, had bought him from the Ishmaelites who had brought him down there. The Lord was with Joseph. Now you notice I put some words in red. That's me. That's not in your Bible. I'm doing that to highlight these words. I want you to pay attention because these become themes we're going to look at over and over again in Joseph's life. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man, and he was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. From the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had, in house and field. So he left that all that he had in Joseph's charge, and because of him, he had no concern about anything but the food he ate. So, after being sold as a slave, a terrible raw deal to start off, Joseph seems to land on his feet in Egypt. He's bought by a guy named Potiphar, who happens to work for the Egyptian pharaoh, the most powerful man on the earth. Joseph probably starts out as some sort of domestic servant, but quickly demonstrates he's a pretty gifted guy. We find out later he's gifted in administration and organizing, so he probably starts to do that, and Potiphar's no dummy. He realizes, hey, I got a pretty smart guy here. I'm going to let him run more and more of my household. Back to the red words that I highlighted earlier. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all he did to succeed. So Joseph found favor. I want you to see the red words and phrases, because these become themes in all of Joseph's life that we're going to see over the next couple of weeks. The Lord was with Joseph. Joseph found favor. The Lord blessed Joseph with success. Furthermore, notice in verse 3, it says, his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all he did to succeed. So Joseph found favor in his sight. Joseph found favor because Potiphar saw that the Lord was with him, that God was blessing him. Let me take a little sidetrack here. How many of you saw the, have seen the movie that's actually nominated for an Academy Award called Hacksaw Ridge? Anybody? Hacksaw Ridge? Well, that I've seen it twice, actually. It's hard to watch, but it's a really good movie. It might even be a great movie about a great story. It tells the story of a man named Desmond Doss, who was a medic in World War II, but who, as a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, believed he was not permitted to carry a weapon. So technically, he was a conscientious objector. But he went on to receive the Medal of Honor for heroism in the Battle of Okinawa, saving upwards of 75 men single-handedly over that battle. And at a key moment in the movie, when his commander's asking Desmond to go into battle on what is his Sabbath day, a Saturday, he says to Desmond, most of these men don't believe the same way you do, but they believe so much in how much you believe. That's a powerful line. There's just something about this Hebrew slave that Potiphar can't help but notice. Maybe he couldn't put his finger on it. Maybe he couldn't put words to it. He just knew that everything Joseph touched succeeded. Everything he touched turned to gold. He was blessed by having this Hebrew in his house. Here's the reason. The Lord was with him. Now, at this point, we're thinking, okay, that's good. That's a good thing for Joseph. Good for him. After the lousy start and the raw deal, he deserves a break. Now we get to the next part of the story, which I'm calling, you got to be kidding me. Are you kidding me? Genesis 39:6. Now Joseph was handsome in form and appearance. The ancient Hebrew literally says he was well-built and good-looking. In case you wonder what that means, I found an example on our own church staff. This is a lesson. Be careful what you put on Facebook, right? Here's a better look at Pastor Sterling Moore, who's going to be our new campus pastor down when we open up our Mill Creek campus this coming fall. Sterling was afraid I would do that, and I did. So, verse 7. After a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, lie with me. Now, the Bible is not a prudish book. It's often shockingly PG-13, even more than that. But he refused and said to his master's wife, behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And as she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not listen to her, to lie beside her, or to be with her. Whenever I read this story, or remember it, I think of a story my dad has told many times, and I've used it before. You may recall it. But years ago, he had to spend 1 year, he was been a pastor for like 60 years, and he spent 1 year working outside the local church for a mission agency that was located in Dallas, Texas. So he spent most of a year driving around southeastern United States, raising awareness and raising funds for this particular mission group. And one time he was driving by himself, I think through southern Arkansas somewhere. Toward the end of a day, he was tired and hungry, so he stopped at just a little diner in a small town in Arkansas. That's how I remember the story. And he went in. Now my dad, in all his years of ministry, has counseled many, many men, and even many pastors, who had gone through what we might call relational temptation issues. And he had counseled them, but he had always wondered why he had never himself had such an uncomfortable situation happen, like Potiphar's wife. But anyway, he's at this restaurant, he orders his food. He notices almost right away that this young waitress, like half his age, is just paying a little extra attention to him, like being a little extra nice, you know, sweetie, honey, that kind of stuff. But even more than that, would like put her hand on his shoulder when she brought the iced tea and would be, lean over. And he could, at one point he said she was so close, he could smell her perfume. And he started to get a little bit nervous, like, well, maybe she has a thing for older men. Maybe she's attracted to me. Maybe this is my moment of relational temptation. So he starts to sweat and pray and think, and he's watching her, and he doesn't know what to do. Finally, get to the end of the meal. She's all the way across the restaurant getting coffee for somebody. She looks up, she makes eye contact with him, and walks all the way through the tables to him, never taking her eyes off his. Gets right to his table, leans over really close, puts her hand on his shoulder and says, I suppose you've noticed I can't take my eyes off of you. He looks up, and then she goes, you remind me exactly of my grandfather. One of my favorite stories. My mom loves that story. So Joseph is young and handsome and successful. Potiphar's wife makes herself available to him. We don't really know why. Maybe she's lonely in her marriage. Maybe she's angry. We don't know. But she makes herself available. Now, there are a lot of things Joseph could be telling himself at this moment to give himself reason to take advantage of this situation. I've had a pretty raw deal here. My own brother sold me as a slave. I'm living in a foreign land, working for this guy Potiphar. Yeah, I deserve a break. Yeah, okay. No one's going to know. But he doesn't. Notice why he resists. But he refused and said to his master's wife, behold, my master has put everything he has in my charge, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He refuses to dishonor his master. He refuses to sin against God because he's grateful, because of gratitude. Now here we see something amazing, I think. We see the growth in character that Joseph has already experienced. He's no longer the young brother, the spoiled one, tattling on his older brothers. He is now a man of great integrity and great strength of character. We see that not only has the Lord been with him in Egypt, but the Lord has been teaching him while he's a slave. Surely now we think God will reward him, right? He's done the right thing. Verse 11, but one day when he went into the house to do his work and none of the men of the house was there in the house, she caught him by his garment saying, lie with me. She was persistent. But he left his garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house. And as soon as she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled out of the house, she called to the men of her household and said to them, see, he has brought among us a Hebrew to laugh at us. He came into me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And as soon as he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and fled, and I got out of the house. Then she laid up his garment by her until his master came home. And she told him the same story, saying, the Hebrew servant whom you have brought among us came into me to laugh at me. But as soon as I lifted up my voice and cried, he left his garment beside me and fled out of the house. It doesn't look good for Joseph. Verse 19, as soon as his master heard the words that his wife spoke to him, this is the way your servant treated me, his anger was kindled, and Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in prison. Are you kidding me? So Joseph does the right thing. He resists temptation. He honors his master. He honors God and still winds up in an Egyptian dungeon. He's back where he started, only worse. Back in December, and I shared this a few weeks ago, my wife and I traveled to San Francisco. We were able to make a quick visit out to Alcatraz Island. Anybody ever visited Alcatraz? Know anything about it? Well, it's a fascinating place, and it's kind of creepy, too. Cells are 5 feet by 9 feet by 7 feet. I could stand in the middle of one of those cells, touch both walls with my hands. Alcatraz was considered the toughest prison in America for many years, and I kept wondering what prison life would be like. There were some men who spent 17 years in those cells, like 23 hours a day. What would that be like? Couldn't have been good. But my guess is Alcatraz was like the Ritz-Carlton compared to an ancient dungeon in Egypt. Because in Alcatraz, every prisoner had their own cell, their own toilet, their own running water. I don't think those luxuries existed in ancient Egypt. At this point, we're thinking, now this has got to be it. This will be the last we hear of Joseph. He's gone. Surely he would have given up on God by now. Verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners. Have we heard that before? Who were in the prison. Whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. And the keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was in Joseph's charge because the Lord was with him. And whatever he did, the Lord made it succeed. The last point I want to get at here is that Joseph knows the favor of God. The favor of God. Most of you know the story of Charles Colson, the late Charles Colson, once one of the most powerful men in Washington, Nixon's hatchet man, he was called, but later got caught up in the Watergate scandal, spent 7 months in a federal penitentiary. But before he went into prison, a friend of his shared the gospel with Charles Colson. And for the first time in his life, he recognized the bankruptcy of his heart and his life in the face, in the front of a holy God. And he understood the gospel, he repented of his sin, and gave his heart to Christ as Lord and Savior. As we say, gospel gives you new heart, new identity, new purpose, and new destiny. He experienced all that. And then he went into prison for 7 months. And for the rest of his life, Charles Colson said prison was the best thing that ever happened to him. Because it was in prison that he found, that he got the experience to found what became one of the largest prison ministries in the whole world called Prison Fellowship. And he eventually wrote a book called Born Again. He even preached at our East Campus in the early 80s. But when we get to this part of Joseph's story, we want to say, hold on just a second. If being thrown into an Egyptian dungeon for something I did not do is the favor of God, maybe we want to give that favor to somebody else. I'd like to be favored a little less than that. What is favor? What's the story telling us? I think the story's telling us that God's favor is not necessarily what we sometimes think it is. For example, it was not found in Joseph's favored status with his own father. Wasn't found in the coat of many colors. That almost got him killed. Wasn't even found in his handsome appearance and form. We all want that, right? That also got him into trouble. God's favor is defined in three very clear ways. First, in his steadfast love. Verse 21, but the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor. Now, the word translated as steadfast love is the great Hebrew word hesed. It means mercy, kindness, and covenant loyalty. And it's almost always used to describe the love of God, not anything else. The love of God. A friend in church gave me a worship CD a while back, and I was listening to it recently, and there's a song on there called Closer Than You Know. And in that song, there's a line. Don't turn your eyes from me. My love won't be undone. I love that line. Do you know there's nothing you can do to keep God from loving you? Do you know there's nothing you can do to make him love you any less or any more than he does right now? Because his love is steadfast. It's dependent on him, not on you. Secondly, God's favor is described in this story as his presence. Four times in the story, and you heard it, we read the line, the Lord was with him. In fact, the Lord's presence shows up in two places where we least expect it. In the house of Potiphar, who is an Egyptian, which means he was a pagan, likely a sun worshiper, and in the dungeon, in the Egyptian prison. Do you know there's no place you can go in your life to be outside of God's presence? Psalm 139 says, where can I flee from your spirit? Where can I go from your presence? If I make my bed in the depths of the earth, you are there. If I go to the heights of the heavens, you are there. If I go to the farthest side of the sea, see, even there you hold me fast. God's favor, thirdly, is described as God's blessing. Verse 21 says, but the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor. And then down in verse 23, and whatever he did, the Lord made it succeed. He blessed Joseph. Now, what we see in this part of the story of Joseph's life, and there's much more to come over the next couple of weeks, is that God's favor, his love, his presence, and blessing show up in unusual places, especially in the darkest and most unjust times of Joseph's life. But we might say, well, you know, that's Joseph. He's a Bible guy. I'm just an ordinary person. What about my life? What about me? What's this got to do with me? Well, like the poor farmer in the Chinese parable, and like Joseph, our lives can take unforeseen twists and turns. Sometimes those twists and turns are scary, painful, or lonely. Sometimes they're the result of our own decisions and behavior. Unlike Joseph, maybe you said yes to your moment of temptation, and you carry regret or guilt because of that. Or unlike Joseph, maybe you did become angry and bitter toward God and maybe gave up on him. Maybe you feel like giving up on him right now. Sometimes our struggles are the results of the decisions of someone else, someone else's sin. You're abused in a relationship. You lose a job at no fault of your own. A spouse is unfaithful. Other times, the things that happen to us seem to be completely at random. A loved one is facing chemotherapy. Or a pregnancy ends in a miscarriage and no one can tell you why. The story of Joseph tells us that God's favor is not known so much in the events of our lives, but in his steadfast love that never changes, that never lets us go, in his presence that never leaves us, always willing to wrestle with us as God wrestled with Jacob through the night, he wrestles with us, and in his blessing, even in an Egyptian prison, maybe especially in an Egyptian prison. Now, all year long, we've been learning that these Old Testament stories, these Old Testament promises, have an arc in the Bible, that they arc from the Old Testament all the way to the New Testament, because all the promises are then fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Listen to how the Apostle Paul attaches, I believe, the story of Joseph, what we're seeing there, with the promise of Christ. It's in Romans chapter 8. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. Verse 31, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I believe that's the story of Joseph translated into the language and faith of the New Testament. That he learned through the undeserved and undesired events of his life that nothing could separate him from God's love, presence, blessing, and favor. Nothing. Not the hate of his own brothers, not being sold as a slave, not being thrown into an Egyptian prison for something he didn't do. Nothing. And I think that's also our story as well. I think it's your story. Because this is the gospel. Because of what Christ has accomplished and already done on your behalf, nothing can separate you from his love. Nothing in your life is beyond the reach of his promise and redemption. Nothing. Would you bow with me as I close in prayer? Lord God, I thank you today for your word, even for this ancient story that comes to us through the centuries, a story that's really also our story. We thank you for the promise of your steadfast love, a love that never changes, a love that's based on you, not on us, for your presence and your blessing in all the circumstances of our lives. Most of all, we thank you today that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ Jesus, our Lord. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. It is well with my soul. I hope and pray that it is with you. But if today your soul is troubled in some way and you'd like to spend a few moments in prayer, maybe seeking the favor of God in your life or in a relationship, we have prayer partners available. Following benediction, just come up and spend some time with us. We'd like to do that with you. As you leave today, remember Royal Family Kids Camp if you want to pick up information. We'd love to see you Tuesday night at our prayer and worship event as well. And if you can stay around a couple minutes, help us stack the chairs. We appreciate that very much. Receive now today's benediction. May we go now in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, whose love is steadfast, whose presence never leaves, and whose favor is promised. Amen. Have a great day.